That don't kill me, can only make me stronger. I need you to hurry up now, cause I can't wait much longer. I know I got to be right now, cause I can't get much stronger. Man, I've been waiting all night now, that's how long I've been on ya. Let's get lost tonight. You could be my black cape.
With thinking about the physics of running, try to think of your limbs as pendulums. A pendulum's velocity is not determined by the weight at the bottom, rather, by the length. The shorter the pendulum is, the faster it goes.
Watch Greg as he attempts to run a lap with his arms and legs fully extended. One hour later. Now, Greg will try and run a lap with his arms and legs bent. Remember, the shorter the pendulum, the faster the velocity. .2 seconds later. Greg Pizzuti, how do you do it?
It's all about the pendulums, baby.
The most important part of a sprinting event is the beginning of the race. Races are often decided by 1/10 or even 1/100th of a second, so what one does when the gun goes off often separates the winners from the losers. That is why sprinters today are using as much new technology as possible, such as customized blocks and innovative footwear.
At the ancient Olympics in Greece, runners stood upright with their toes in a groove at the starting line. Ever since, many different models of acceleration have been used until 1920s when starting blocks were introduced. They were first used in the 1948 Olympics in London and have been a key component in sprinting ever since. The most effective start involving blocks is the crouch start. Runners must accelerate quickly or else they will fall because their center of gravity is forced to move ahead of their feet. The starting blocks are key because of Newton's third law of motion. For every force, there is an equal and opposite force. And when a runner pushes off the starting blocks, the blocks in turn thrust him forward.
Along with starting blocks, the type of footwear a runner chooses is also very important.
Shoes need to be very light, with a tight fit, so that no energy is wasted lifting a heavier shoe. With lighter shoes, runners could have more mobility in their feet, and therefore have a quicker turnover rate. Shoes need to be tied tightly, and with the material inside, the coefficient of friction always stays the same. Therefore, when you increase the normal force, the static friction force will also increase, and will help the foot from slipping, and no energy is lost. Spikes also offer a distinct advantage to runners, because they give you traction and prevent you from slipping. Since energy equals force times distance, if you slip, you lose energy through the distance you slip. When a spike drives into the ground, more surface is being pushed by the ground, and it helps you accelerate, since according to Newton, for every force, there is an equal and opposite force.
When running, form and equipment are important, but there is another factor that is also extremely crucial. That is the runner's body. Ideal runners are small and light with strong, lean muscle. Since force equals mass times acceleration, we know that with an equal applied force, a larger mass will have less acceleration than a smaller mass. A common misconception is that taller people will make better runners. However, stride length does not determine speed. Running requires that you lift your body off the ground with each step, propelling yourself forward. The more you weigh, the harder you have to work to lift your body, and therefore, the slower you will be. The principles hold true mostly for distance running. Sprinters need more mass because they need more muscle in order to create more force on the track and propel themselves forward. Every type of runner needs the most proficient amount of muscle mass for their distance. In distance running, the less a runner weighs while still maintaining enough muscle mass, the faster he or she will be. Less force is required to overcome gravity and propel the runner forward, meaning the runner will be faster, less tired, and more efficient.
Okay, yeah.
When
Another reason why people enjoy the activity of running is that it is a great way to maintain great physical shape as well as stay healthy. When you run, your body burns calories. A calorie is a unit of energy, particularly heat. A pound of fat is equal to 3,500 calories. To lose 1 pound a week, you will need to expend 3,500 more calories than you take in by either increased activity or decreased eating or both. Your weight times distance is equal to the total amount of energy used. The energy burned off while running is the amount of calories that you use. Time is not as important as distance. In order to burn more calories, you should increase your distance before you start to run faster. Okay. David Swain, the director of the Wellness Institute and Research Center at Old Dominion University, who also has a PhD in exercise physiology, explains how running has proven to burn more calories than walking. Swain explains, when you perform a continuous exercise, you burn 5 calories for every liter of oxygen you consume. And running in general consumes a lot more oxygen than walking. Overall, if you run for 20 minutes or walk for 50 minutes, you'll end up burning the same number of calories. So in other words, on average, you have to walk 2.5 times longer than you would have to run to burn the same number of calories.
Wow, I just burned a lot of calories.
Another controversial topic is whether indoor or outdoor running burns more calories. A number of studies have shown that in general, outdoor running burns about 5% more calories than treadmills do. This is due in part because there is greater wind resistance outside and you have no assistance from the treadmill belt.
How many? Now?
Yeah. That was night vision.
Yeah.
Night
vision. Oh my god.
There you go. Night time.
Laura. Nice tumor on your hand.
The most important part of a sprinting event is the beginning of the race.